Let's give God a hand clap for praise. In fact, that wasn't praise, that was worship. There's a difference between praise and worship, because worship is not contingent upon how you feel. Worship is just because God is in the presence. You set the atmosphere when you worship. Oh, ain't nobody listening to me. I don't know about you, but I had to go in a secret place because just looking at the kids being killed, just looking at Buffalo, there was a bomb threat in the school. There was a shooting at Nat Turner School. I don't know about you, but I didn't have no much strength. I was starting to tears to fall. But I'm grateful on today that there's still a God, and he's still moving in spite of, see, if you don't know nothing else. An empath is one that feels for others. It ain't just emotional. That means I can feel your hurt. I can feel your grief. I can feel whatever it is that's going on with you. So I'm glad on today, if ain't nothing else, just to be in the building. To God.
Hallelujah.
To God be the glory.
Yes, God. Yes, God. Yes,
God. To God, I don't know. Just yes, to God. I just, okay, if you saw my Facebook tag, it says Makeba Dance Worshipper.
Hallelujah.
So before anything else, I have to worship God.
Yes, God. Yes, God. Yes, God. Yes, God. Hallelujah.
Even when I don't feel like it, I have to worship God.
Yes, 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 yes.
Because as the testimonies went forth, I just sat and I just thought about it. Because 2 weeks ago, I was sitting with COVID, and I was mad and I was upset because I had two shots. I've been boosted, and I couldn't understand why I was. And then I heard the woman say, sometimes God just needs you to sit down, because I was ripping and running. I was doing so much. I said, God, I didn't want to sit down like that. But sometimes God will sit you out to get your attention. And then I was starting to be upset. And sometimes the encourager needs someone to encourage them. So I'm grateful for my mother on today, because she said, remember in 2020 when I got COVID, there was no vaccine, there was no booster shot, there was no medication. So I, and I'm still here. So I had to look back and say, thank you, God.
Thank you, God.
Yes, God. Because it could have been worse. But God spared me. And it wasn't just the vaccine. And it wasn't just the booster. Okay, I'm going to move on. I give God the glory that is due his name. I give honor to Pastor Collier in his absence for allowing me to stand at this sacred pulpit. I'm going to say allowing, because I'm one of those that you shouldn't allow just anyone and everybody standing on your pulpit if you don't know what spirit. Okay, I'm going to leave that's another topic on its own. But I'm glad he allowed me to stand in this sacred pulpit on tonight. So in his absence, I give honor to the shepherds of this church. I give honor to Dr. Lewis, who saw fit to allow me to even speak on today. This young vessel, this praise dancer, he didn't even know how I even talk or nothing, but he entrusted that he knew God was going to do something on tonight. And to all the ministers that are present, and your honor, I give you honor. I give honor to my very own pastor, Del Roger Dunmore, and First Lady Dunmore of Versailles Hill Baptist Church in North New Jersey for allowing, I'm going to say that again, of allowing me to come out, because truth be told, you have to be in order. You can minister all you want to, but if your pastor say no, you have to be okay. Nobody don't like that either. See, people get mad. I'm gonna go to the word, but people get mad when their pastor tell them no. Maybe there's a reason that he saw something in the spirit that you don't know, because you have to be in order even when you a minister and a pastor, because he is your covering. So I thank him on tonight for allowing me to be here.
Amen. Yes.
So I'm gonna go forth on tonight. Bless me, Lord, on tonight. I'll be coming from 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 18, and I'll be coming from the Amplified Version. It says, for you know that you were not redeemed from your useless, spiritual, unproductive way of life, inherited by tradition from your forefathers with perishable things like silver and gold, but you were actually purchased with precious blood, like that of sacrificial lamb, unblemished and spotless, the priceless blood of Christ. For he was ordained foreknown before the foundation of the world, but has appeared publicly in these last times for your sake. So if I had to give a topic on tonight, it would be, there is power in the blood of Jesus.
Amen. Amen.
There is power in the blood of Jesus.
Yes, love. Yes, God. Yes, God.
Jesus died as a substitute for us, by paying the death penalty for our sins, which we could not pay ourselves. Forgiveness of sins through the power of Jesus' shed blood is still available to all who would receive. It is a free gift from God. Regardless of how deep in sin, I'll say that again, regardless of how deep in sin you may have gone or may still be, the blood of Jesus is able to cleanse you from sin and unrighteousness. So why is the blood important? Blood is so important that it is mentioned in the Bible around 700 times.
Say that again.
Blood is so important that it's mentioned in the Bible around 700 times. So just follow me for a minute, all right? It says your natural blood supplies life, giving oxygen and nutrients to every cell in your body. If the flow of blood was to be cut off from any area of your body, you will begin to die. So spiritually speaking, if we want to talk it on the spiritual end, it says any part of your life that is cut off from the blood of Jesus is dead or dying.
I like that.
So spiritually speaking, if any part of your life that is cut off from the blood of Jesus, you're dead or dying. Let's go a little further. Why the blood is important. Our blood also carries away waste and toxins, from your cells. Spiritually, without the blood of Jesus, your life will be filled with filth. Thank God for the blood of Jesus that removes the dirt of sin from our daily lives. God also equipped our body with white blood cells that fight off sickness. Anytime bacteria or viruses try to get in your body, the white blood starts destroying what is known as invaders. When your natural is healthy, you are protected from disease. But when you are spiritually healthy, there isn't anything the devil can bring against you that the blood of Jesus is sufficient to overcome. There is life in the blood. So let me see if you don't understand this. So you have to excuse me. I was a nursing major, so I had to break it down in a way that God allowed me. So in other words, when you think of the white blood cells, those are in our body naturally to protect us from any bacteria, any viruses that may come. And I like the word invaders. That means there's something in it that's foreign, that it ain't supposed to be there. So when you're naturally healthy, you're protected from a disease. But when you're spiritually healthy, it isn't anything that the devil can bring against you that the blood of Jesus isn't significant to overcome. There is life in the blood. So what happens when you apply the blood of Jesus? Number one, it provides forgiveness of your sins. The scripture already told us what Jesus did for us, so it already lets us know that whatever happens and when you apply the blood of Jesus, it already provides forgiveness of your sins. Number two, the blood gives you life. We already just saw that if the blood stops flowing, you may die. So once you have the blood of Jesus and you apply it to your life, it brings on life. It brings you close to God because he died for us. We are already close to him. Oh, all right, somebody gonna be upset about this point because it says it cleanses your conscience. Okay, what does cleanse mean? Cleanse means it means to be free from guilt. Your conscience is basically an inner feeling or voice viewed as acting as a guide to the rightness or wrongness of one's behavior. In other words, that's the voice in your head. I know nobody in today needs to be cleansed from their conscience. I know everybody on here is on the straight path, but truth be told, your conscience will let you know to do right or wrong. That night when you shouldn't have went over to that man's house. That night you shouldn't have went over to that woman's house. That night when you know you shouldn't have been to the party. That night when you know you were supposed to have been where you're supposed to have been in church. That is your conscience. But I'm glad on today that God cleanses us from our conscience when we don't do what is right. What happens when you apply the blood of Jesus? It gives you boldness to approach God. I don't know about you, but back in the Bible, it used to be the priest had to go before you to ask for certain things for God in the tabernacle. And guess what? If the priest wasn't right, some of them would drop dead in a moment. I'm glad on today that I don't need no priest. I'm glad I don't have to go to confession. I'm glad I don't have to go to my pastor. I'm glad I have to go to anybody to tell them. I can go straight to God, and I can go to God with boldness. What happens with the blood of Jesus, you apply it. It sanctifies you. Sanctify means it sets you apart. It frees you from sin. It consecrates you. So in other words, because of the blood, and when you apply it, you are set apart from other people in this world. Truth be told, as Christians, we call ourselves Christians, but are we really? Because it looks like some of us are still of the world. Sanctify. Consecrate. Truth be told, some of us not to just do 30-day fasting. Some of us need to do a whole consecration month.
Amen.
To cleanse us and sanctify us. Mm-hmm. Because some of us are not walking rightly with God. I didn't say be perfect, because we serve a perfect God. I'm just saying Christian means to be Christ-like.
Come on.
Not a church folk.
Amen. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Amen. Preach.
When you apply the blood of Jesus, it cleanses you. It means it makes you clean. It purifies you. The blood of Jesus heals you. It enables you to overcome the devil and his works. See, I like that part. It says overcome the devil and his works, because you can overcome something or someone, but not the works that is doing to you. So it allows you to overcome his works. I don't know about you. That means I'm talking about the people that's gossiping about you, the people that has all these things about you, the people that stabbed you in the back, the people that smile in your face, the people that you think was your friend but ain't your friend, the one that got a promotion before you and walking around flaunting like they did something, the one that said, okay, let's take it back because I know none of this happened. The people in the church ministry, the auxiliaries, all the way down to the leaders, down to the back pew, to the lay person. It enables you to overcome the devil and his works. So I'm almost about to close. Those that know me, I don't preach long. I do what I got to do and move on out the way. It says, how do we apply the blood of Jesus in our lives? First things first, we need to pray. I'm going to say that again. We need to pray. And I'm not talking about you got to have an hour of prayer. Personally, let's know prayer means a conversation with God. Because I can talk to God in my natural language and he understands, because you know what? God knows each and every one of them. I don't have to have a cute prayer. I don't have to do anything. All I can do is say, Jesus, please help me on today. You have to pray and have a prayer life, not just when it's Wednesday for prayer night prayer, not when it's Tuesday night or whatever night is called by the church, not when your leaders ask you to come on to a prayer call. You need to wake up in the morning. You need to go to bed praying. You need to, matter of fact, before you step out the door, pray.
Amen.
My God.
Amen.
As a woman said, we getting out in the open. Pray over your food. Pray over the waiter that's in the back. Pray over the one that cooked the food.
Amen.
We apply the blood of Jesus in our lives because we confess our sins to God.
Amen.
I'm going to say that again. To God.
Yes.
Not your bestie. Not everybody on Facebook. Or Instagram or Twitter.
Amen.
To God.
You confess your sins to God.
Yeah.
Because why? He loves you unconditionally.
Yeah.
Why? He ain't gonna go back and say what he saw on the book, on Instagram or the Twitter. He ain't gonna judge you. He gonna still give you grace and mercy.
Yes.
Confess your sins to God. Speak a word over yourself.
Amen.
Speak a word over yourself.
Amen.
And in order to do that, you have to know a word, which means you have to open your Bible.
Amen.
And find a scripture.
Yes.
Thank you, God.
Not the scripture that Sister or Minister Joanne used on last week. A scripture that was by God. Because sometimes I just open the Bible and I wonder why the scripture fell out, but then I realized it needed to spill out because that's what God wanted me to read.
Amen.
Yes, yes, yes.
Amen.
Speak the word over yourself. The songwriter says, which is one of my favorite songs, encourage yourself. And guess what? That came from the scripture of David.
Amen. Yeah,
amen.
Yeah.
Because David was going through a whole lot of stuff.
Amen.
And he ain't have nobody to encourage him. Encourage yourself.
Amen.
And then the song says, in the Lord.
Amen.
So after you encourage yourself in the Lord, And lastly, you apply the blood of Jesus because of your living testimony. All y'all testimonies y'all had today, y'all helped me with this sermon, because praise be to God. Your testimony alone showing how the blood of Jesus is applied to your life. Amen. If your sister can be fell, hit her head more than one time.
Yes, yes, yes.
Don't have no blockage, don't have no hemorrhage, don't have no tumor.
Jesus.
That's the testimony.
Hallelujah.
Without the blood of Jesus, we are defenseless against the devil and his works.
Amen.
It is good to do good works, have a high degree of mortality, and even have a devotional life.
Yes,
but none of these things matter alone or can cleanse you or heal you or protect you. When it comes to your healing, your protection, and your deliverance, the blood of Jesus of what can do that? The blood of Jesus will never lose its power. There is power in the blood of Jesus.
Yes.
So on tonight, I hope something encouraged you on tonight to let you know that there is power in the blood of Jesus. And a matter of fact, we have been redeemed because of the blood of Jesus. I like to say, I have been redeemed. Now go tell that, because sometimes people like to talk about what you done did, but I'm glad on tonight that because of the blood, I have been redeemed. No matter what you say about me, no matter if you like me, no matter if my dance ain't well, I speak well, I pray well, I'm glad on tonight that the blood still works, because truth be told, it ain't for you. My speaking is what God gave me. I'm just a messenger, and I'm just a vessel, because it has to give me first before I can deliver it to anybody else.
Go ahead, go ahead, go ahead.
The blood still works. I'm still on that the blood still works. I'm still on that that the blood protects me. I'm still on that he heals me and forgives. I'm still at that there's power in the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah, says.
I'm glad to know that God even saw fit to show us how it works naturally and how it can help deal with us spiritually. And we try to understand why things are going wrong with our bodies. Because spiritually, you messed up. Spiritually, something is going on with you that comes back out on the outside.
Yes.
One of my things I said, your inside should match your outside.
Say so, say so.
Because if you're ugly on the inside, you're ugly on the outside.
Amen, 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 amen.
I don't care how much makeup you do. I don't care how much your hair looks good. I don't care that good suit you put on. If your inside is not matching your outside, what's the point?
Amen, amen.
When they talked about this, they said this was a crusade. And they talked about how we wanted to reach the masses. I'm grateful for my pastor, because I had to learn, even with dance ministry, that he had to tell me, like, sis, it's not about the numbers.
That's right.
Whoever's supposed to be here is supposed to be here.
Amen.
And you still do your assignment, regardless if it's one person or 50.
Amen.
Because who is supposed
Amen.
To reach is going to reach.
Amen.
But when I thought about the crusade and how it said that the blood still works. So God also gave me something that said, will the real laborers please stand up?
That's right.
A laborer is someone that works.
Yeah.
And they don't have to wait for you to give them an assignment to work. A laborer doesn't ask for nothing in return. A laborer don't have set time or hours. Sometimes they're interrupted because they're a laborer.
Amen, amen, amen.
So I just want to know, will the real laborers please stand up?
Amen,
because there's work to be done outside of the four walls. I don't know, God has given me to go this way. But out of the four walls, because we so get caught up saving, which is fine, saving those in the church. But truth be told, they should be off of the milk by now.
Amen. Say so.
Because they should be getting ready to go through the process to minister to somebody else that comes in. So we have to get out of the four walls. And I thought how I was blessed on Saturday to do the first prayer walk, and I kept on saying, well, it's 90 degrees, ain't nobody gonna be out there, but it was okay. And I say that to say this because Apostle Who in the absence said, girl, you bold. Because I did. I walked right over to the motorcycle crew. And I stepped right in there and I began to pray. And after I prayed, the guy said, I need to contact you because I think I need you to continue to be the blessing before we go out on the street. Amen. So you never know what your ministry is going to entail. But you have to be a laborer first. You have to get yourself out there and stop being afraid. Yes, it's a dangerous place. But guess what? If we're all Christians, right? God gives us wisdom and discernment. He will give you the time when to speak, when to be quiet, and even when to go say something to a person.
Amen.
God never leaves you by yourself.
Amen. Amen.
And the word said laborers. That means Dr. Lewis shouldn't be doing everything.
Amen.
Your pastor shouldn't be doing everything. And you wonder why they're overwhelmed and sick. Because there's no laborers in the building to take over because they're afraid to leave. Because they don't know what's going to happen when they're not there. Will the real laborers please stand up?
That's a word.
Take your rightful place. Do what God called you to do.
Hallelujah.
I don't know why he's taking me this way, but do what God told you to do. Not.
Say it.
If your pastor called you to do something, you do it begrudgingly. I'd rather you just sit down.
That's right.
Because that means that it's not going to go forth in the right way. God wants a sincere heart.
Amen.
He wants you to be sincere whatever you do to serve.
Yes.
Oh, yes.
If I have to get an attitude just because I said for you to ask to do the prayer in the morning. And truth be told, a prayer is just something simple. Everybody knows how to pray. So we have to learn that there's power in the blood of Jesus, but God is also calling the laborers. He's calling those that's been in the cave too long. I don't know who this is for, but prophetically, God is saying those that's been in the cave too long, that's in the background, God's saying it's need for you to come forth because he got something for you to do.
Amen.
Don't be afraid of the men and the faces. Do what God called you to do. God has a purpose. He has a plan for you. God will send who it is his need to come. And even if he doesn't, the word says pray for the laborers to come help you in the harvest. Because if you're praying for the right laborer, you know who you got that's going to be helping you.
Okay. Amen.
I'm gonna leave that alone. But that is what God is saying. That the blood still works. It covers us. It heals us. It forgives us. I thank you for the blood. I thank you for the blood. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by mornings. New mercies I see. Not even morning. Day by day, second by second, minute by minute, hour by hour, month by month, year by year. New mercies. I see.
Yes, Lord.
There's power in the blood.
Yes, Lord.
It reaches the masses.
Yes.
I don't know, but I'm just emotional, like I said today. But a kid, so even with that, the blood still reaches Texas, Buffalo, California, Newark, your homes.
Yes, Lord.
Your jobs,
yeah.
Your ministries.
Yes.
But you have to apply it.
Amen.
Yes.
You have to apply it.
Amen, sis.
You can't be afraid to speak those things that be. I even think about the time my neighbor was even laughing at me, but I didn't care. That time when it was COVID and my mother had it. And I thought of Moses when they told him, put the blood over the doorpost. I may not have no sacrificial lamb, but I took me a red scarf. I took my anointed oil and I hung it over my doorpost. And I prayed and I said, death will not come up in here on today. Sometimes you gotta go back. That's what the word says.
Say so, sis. Say
My mother one day said, why is my sheet so oily? I said, because I done went in your room and put oil in everything that I saw in that room.
Yes, yes, yes.
I anointed that doorknob. I anointed everything in this house. Because I rebuke anything that should not be. That's the blood. Amen. We may not physically have a sacrificial lamb, but we got something that we can cover our...
Hallelujah. Say it. That's right.
Sometimes you got to go back.
Oh, yes.
Because I remember them Church of God in Christ moments. My babysitter took me to, they don't even have them no more, the tent revivals.
Yeah.
I remember the wailing benches. I remember people laying with the sheets over them. I remember them people having me in a circle and saying, the blood of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
We need to get back.
Yes.
We need to get back.
Yes.
Prayer may not be in school, but you can pray outside the gate.
Amen.
When they have a moment in silence, you can tell your child, while you in silence, you better usher a prayer up.
Amen.
The blood still works.
It still works.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Talk about this is old. This ain't old.
Yes.
This is what it is.
Yes.
This is the command, and this is what God did for us.
Amen.
Yeah.
So how we not honor it and appreciate it? He didn't have to die. We was a hot mess.
Yes. Amen. Say so, sis.
And he even forgave the ones that killed him. So that means if he can forgive those, we can forgive some people. Did I say it was going to be easy? No.
Amen.
Sure not.
Amen.
I'm a work in progress every day.
Amen.
But I know if I don't forgive, God won't forgive me for the sins that nobody knows about.
Amen.
That I ain't even come to God about yet.
Yes.
So I need to forgive. So as I close on tonight, I just say thank you. I hope something was said on tonight that at least encouraged someone. I'm not a hooping and hollering person. I'm one that when God gives it to me, I have to give it to him. But I know whatever he gives me, that is what I'm going to do. I'd be also obedient of the Spirit. Because I'm one of those, because I actually changed this. I was going to say something else. But I have learned to be obedient in the Spirit just through my dancing alone. Because sometimes God, people request you for a theme to speak, but that's not what God wants you to say. We got to stop getting caught up too with themes.
Amen.
It's nice to have one. It's nice to have order. But if God gave me a word, I'm going to give it to what he gave me. So I'm sorry to get upset that I didn't follow your theme. Because I have to follow God first.
That's right.
Hallelujah.
Say so.
Thank you, God. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you on tonight.
Yeah.
We thank you, Father God, that whatever said and done on tonight, Father God, encouraged and inspired someone on tonight. We know that the blood still works. We thank you for your grace and mercy, even when we have messed up. Father God, we just so grateful on tonight you allow that the church doors is open. Father God, even though there may not be people in here, allow the atmosphere to be set on the outside, that people will hear and want to come in. I pray for overflow for this church and this ministry. I pray for overflow for everybody that is in this room. I pray for someone that may be in need of a healing of sickness or disease. I pray as you go to the doctor that you will trust and believe that God said it will be done. I pray for those that may be dealing with asthma, respiratory issues, sciatica, lupus, cancer, arthritis, stomach issue, headaches, migraines, back aches, whatever it is, high blood pressure, low blood pressure, glucose levels high. I pray for whatever in disease or sickness you may have right now. In the name of Jesus, Father God, I pray on tonight someone may be looking for a financial breakthrough. I pray, matter of fact, there'll be overflow in your bank account that you have so much that you have to give it out. I pray, Father God, in the name of Jesus, that someone is looking to open up a business. God said it is your time. God said, a matter of fact, write the vision and make it known. God said, if you're looking for a vehicle, go to the lot, put your hand on it. God said, if you're looking for a house, go to the house and pick it out and say, God, I got it. God said, whatever. You are in need of just trust and believe and say it. Speak it right now in the atmosphere, right now in the name of Jesus. God said when praises go up, blessings come down. I'm looking for the blessing, Lord. I will praise you in season or out of season. I will praise you if they don't want me or don't like me. I thank you, Jesus. Father God, as we close, there's someone on today, Father God, that just need peace. I see in my spirit. Someone needs peace. Someone is struggling with something right now, a decision they have to make. I ask for the peace right now to come. Right now in the name of Jesus. The peace that surpasses all understanding. Right now in the name of Jesus. I pray, Father God, as we go forth or continue about our night, that we don't forget those that are suffering, that are dying. I pray for Ukraine right now. I pray for our nation as a whole. I pray for those officials that have been newly elected that don't get caught up in their titles, but know what the mission and the vision is to continue the work for the city and the community. I pray for our government right now in the name of Jesus as they make forth decisions in the name of Jesus. I pray for our military that has been deployed. I pray for all EMT workers, nurses, doctors, and all those that are on the front line. I pray for all the pastors and ministers that's in this room. I pray, Father God, wherever it is that you have to bring a word, it will bring fire. I pray for the fire that breakthroughs and deliverance will come forth. That be a word like no other that you have ever encountered. Because I pray that the word will come through the Holy Spirit. And in Jesus' name, we pray this prayer. Amen. 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 God bless you.